light is on.
Yeah, turn the light.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. We'll continue the fiqh, inshallah, next week. If we can start at 4, maximum 4:15, so we can have the advantage of the time. We'll do some of the maqasid al-sharia, and if we'll have time, we'll do the tahfa al-iraqiyya, we can make that. Let's be in the late. I'll start at 4 next time, be in the late. At least, if we'll be here, everyone at 4, we can be starting with that. So we can hasten our pace in the study of the Zad al-Mustaqna and starting the book of the Zakat, and we're trying to finish the Ibadat as soon as we can be in that. For Maqasid al-Sharia, the last chapter that we were talking about is the Maqasid al-Sharia in the Tashri' Taghyir wa Taqrir. Taghyir wa Taqrir. We thought that the author, the translation was not, translating the part that we've been studying, but it seems that in the translation they put a book, the chapter of freedom before the other chapter, which is in the original book, the chapter of the freedom comes afterward. قال مقصد الشريعة من التشريع تغيير وتقرير. مقصد الشريعة. One of the objective and the intent of the Sharia is the Taghyir. Just to make reference to the book here, page 165, alteration and confirmation objectives in the Sharia. Alteration and confirmation objectives in the Sharia. We already did this part. The confirmation and the alteration in the Sharia that happened, as we mentioned, it's not done without objectives. It's not done without objectives. I can read the conclusion here. قال فالتغيير والتقرير قد يصادفان أحوال بعض الأمم دون بعض وهو الغالب. For example, the way that the Arab they used to dress and the covering of the woman that they had in the Arab society in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do everyone who accept Islam, the Muslims in other part of the world, they have to cover themselves or to dress the way they've been dressed in the Arab society? That's no. So here, when Islam enter in community or embraced by a community, the covering that happened in this, the spirituality of the covering, the way of the covering. So whatever we'll cover and we'll propose, we'll be presenting the modest way of Islam, it will be, that's the appropriate way, but not exactly, for example, a certain attire who fulfill the modesty. Is any attire that is custom into that society will fulfill the modesty, will be embraced. So the Islam, when we make the changes here, are not the changes just to satisfy whims or to make rigidity for, to obligate the society to change a condition or to be comparable, resembling another society, and that's what we call Islam.
استعينوا
this is part of the element or the aspect who justified the universality of the Islamic Sharia. He's saying here in the end, the confirmation or the alteration, قَدْ يُصَادِفَيْنِ أَحْوَالَ بَعْضَ الْأُمَمْ دُونَ بَعْضٍ. It might, you know, be conform or can be possible for certain conditions of certain nations, but not others. But there's things that they are common to all the communities that they need to abstain or stop from doing it. Example, قَالَ مِثُ تَحْرِيمُ الرِّبَى. The example of forbidden or prohibition of the riba, wujub al-mahri, the obligation of the dowry, ada'u diyya, the fact to pay the diyya, the diyya is the fidya or the ransom that you know the family of the killer by mistake, you know, he has to pay for the family of the killed one. قال وقد يصادفان أحوال البشر كلهم. This is facts are very specific to Islam. So when we talk about the riba, we know the riba is a mafsada. When we talk about the mahr is the dowry that Allah Subhanahu wa Taala obligated on the spouses to give to their, you know, future spouse. وقد يصادفان أحوال البشر كلهم. It might be in the Sharia that people, when Islam being embraced in the community, they know those things that are haram already. When Islam presents them haram, they are being forbidden or known to be, you know, like immoral in society, because they come from the common sense or from the society when they live together, that this is not accepted. Like example, given the example here, قَالَ مِثُ تَحْرِيمُ الْخَمْرِ. Prohibition of alcohol or intoxicant. Everyone knows intoxicant is it's not good, and it leads to a lot of ill things. Therefore, when Islam comes and say it's haram, say, oh yeah, that should be actually prohibited. قال وإبطال الوصية لوارث. For example, having the will for someone who's inheritors, so he's gonna have he's like the one who has the estate, he's going to deprive one of his inheritors from that estate by giving the will, for example, to a specific one of them. So this is, there's a dhulm in it, there's an oppression and kind of injustice and unfairness. So Islam comes to say, no, this is haram. So you see, whatever Islam presenting is presenting the way how to bring people up to level of fairness, to level of equality and justice. وَبِمَا زَادَ عَلَى الثُّلُثِ وَتَقْرِيرُ أَنْكِحَةِ الَّذِينَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. One also of the thing that Islam is to confirm or to adopt the marriage done before Islam. وَمِنْ رَحْمَةِ الشَّرِيعَةِ أَنَّهَا أَبْقَتْ لِلْأُمَمِ مُعْتَادَهَا وَأَحْوَالَهَا الْخَاصَةِ. As I said, I'm reading in the end of that chapter. And from the rahmah of the Sharia, those are aspects, as we said, of the universality of the Sharia of the Islam. So remember we said the part of the, when in the beginning of the study of the book of the Maqasid al-Sharia, we said that Islam doesn't uproot a society from its custom and tradition. Islam embraced those custom and tradition, cleansed them, purify them, and deny everything that conflict with what is common sense and what is just and fair. For example, you say from the tradition before in some country, like it used to happen in the time before Islam in Egypt, they offer to the Nile, you know, a virgin every year. Why? Because they believe that the abundance of the water in the Nile requires sacrifice. So Islam came and he stopped this ill custom. This is not a tradition. This is a tradition based on wrong belief. But, you know, the way they dress, the color that they have, I mean, look, even the architecture, if you remember, we talked about that. For example, if you look at the buildings of masajid, for example, in the subcontinent are different, for example, in the area of the Islamic question, we're talking about, you know, North Africa and, you know, in Spain, in Al-Andalus, different when you see like the structure and the architecture in Al-Sham. So you see those architecture that been, you know, the masajid being built on, it goes back to the tradition that the people they have in those societies. And this is from the rahmah of Islam, to have people keep their identity. So Islam, does it enter to in a society to uproot the society, keep their tradition, keep, actually as a matter of fact, Islam doesn't enter even to take the governance. Because when people they embrace, the one who's among them, he will be leading them. قال إذا لم يكن فيها استرسال على فساد ففي الموطأ أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أيما دار أو أرض قسمت في الجاهلية فهي على قسم الجاهلية. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم now saying any home or land being distributed or kind of, you know, divided in time before Islam will be embraced or accepted the way is being already distributed. وَأَيُّمَا دَارٍ أَوْ أَرْضٍ أَدْرَكَ الْإِسْلَامُ وَلَمْ تُقْسَمْ فَهِي عَلَى قُسْمُ الْإِسْلَامِ. For example, we have a land that is a property of brothers, 10 brothers. The father, he wished to give to one of the brother half of it. The rest, go distribute the rest. So this is in time of jahiliyyah. This is unfair. What? So if it happened, the Prophet ﷺ, what he's telling us here, anything that happened before Islam, we keep it as is. Because if you say to the brother who got half of the whole land, no, you can take back, he's like, you're going to stir back like a progress. Okay. What happened, so everyone who comes to Islam said, alhamdulillah, whatever happened, it happened. But any house or land that going to be distributed after Islam, need to abide to the law of Islam. وَقَدْ قَالَ رَسُولَهُ, and one of the most affected by that is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَقَدْ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم يَوْمَ الْفَتْحِ, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came on the day of the Fath, he didn't have a house in Mecca. قال وهل ترك لنا عقيل من دار عقيل he's you know the uncle of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم عقيل ابن أبي طالب. So all what he has as you know lands and everything he distributed them or he sold them without coming back to the whole family. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said عقيل he didn't leave or leave anything for us. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't go to those lands or homes that, you know, belongs to the family of Abdul Muttalib, of Abi Talib, to reclaim back his rights. He said, as Aqil did it in time of Jahiliyyah's camp. قَالَ وَهَلْ تَرَكَ لَنَا عَقِيلٌ مِنْ دَارٍ يُرِيدُ أَنَّ عَقِيلَ ابْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ فَوَّدَهَا فِي حُكْمِ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ فَلَمْ يَنْقُضْهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ حِينَ فَتَحَ. This is from the أخلاق of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The next chapter, and I believe we touch part of this chapter. The next chapter قال نوط الأحكام الشرعية بمعان وأوصاف لا بأسماء وأشكال. لا بأسماء وأشكال. We said the chapter that we're studying, 165, that we finish. الشريعة is about essences and real attributes, not names and forms. We don't make haram things because of their name. Is it because of their attribute? Is it because of the reason why it's haram? He given us an example here, just going through some of the examples. قال مثل قول بعض الفقهاء, and this is actually is mistake being done by jurists. By jurists, when they missed one of the most important spirit in the Sharia. That's why we're talking about the intent, we're talking about objectives, we're talking about condition, we're talking about reason, and not names. So for example, not anything that you call wine becomes haram. Someone put a banner on a bottle of water and put on it wine. Say, don't drink it, it's haram. Say, yeah, he this water. Say, don't you see his name, wine? He said, well, if they call it wine and alcohol and drugs and everything, I'm going to drink it because this is water, it's not wine. What it make the wine haram because it's intoxicant. This, what is the content of this bottle is not intoxicant. Well, so those who like, you know, and this is not, this is only an example, but if you build on this aspect or on this, these thoughts, it really leads to deviation. قال مثل قول بعض الفقهاء في صنف من الحيتان يسميه بعض الناس خنزير البحر. Some of the jurists, they have an opinion concerning some of the fish. They call it in certain society, they call it خنزير, خنزير البحر, the pork of the sea, or the sea pork. إنه يحرم أكله لأنه خنزير. It's haram because it's a pork. Well, how can it be pork? I mean, it became pork because it's been named pork. Or maybe it looks like, Allahu Akbar. قال, this is an example, and he given more other examples. So it might be the image of certain action look like something that is haram in the time of the Jahili, but we cannot make it haram because the image is like it. You have to look at the attribute, look at the essence, look at the reason, look at the intention behind the actions. قال وإنما حق الفقيه أن ينظر إلى الأسماء الموضوعة للمسمى أصالة أيام التشريع وإلى الأشكال المنظور إليها عند التشريع من حيث إنهما طريق لتعرف الحالة الملحوظة وقت التشريع لتهدينا إلى الوصف المرعي للشارع. Now, when you have things that the Shara, which is the legislator we're talking about, the source of the Quran and the Sunnah, made things to be halal or haram, we have to study the name of it, the attributes, why it became haram. So we should not limit ourselves or restrict ourselves to the appearance. I say, oh, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, so this is haram. He said, no. You have to study why it was haram. So you do not restrict at the appearance to make your judgment. You have to study. And this is what he said. The ahkam of sharia are related to the essences, to the spirit, to the intent, to the objective. Which is will lead us to understand, you know, later, that the implementation of any hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if it doesn't lead to the objective for which it was legislated, then it's not the hukum of Allah. Example, someone who uses the hukum to hurt people, say, this is Allah said this. Said, Allah legislated to shower people with His mercy. So how can this cause the hurting of the people? So the action was done, only the form of the law was executed, not the content. So if you withdraw from the law, its content, it ceases to stop to be a law of Allah. Why? Because the hukum was built based on its intent or attribute, essence, not based on a form. So when we start from this understanding, then when it comes to the implementation, also we'll evaluate the hukum, even though we say this is, we have done it because Allah said so. I said, yes, Allah said so for an objective, well defined, not for the whims that or the agenda that someone wants to push. قال ولقد أخطأ من هنا بعض الفقهاء أخطاء كثيرة. And from here, there's a lot of jurists, they made a lot of big mistakes. Example, قال حكم بعضهم بقتل المشعوذي باعتبار أنهم يسمونه سحار. These people are مشعوذين. مشعوذين, people, you know, who like, you know, people, they go to them seeking help. It's either to write for them some writing that they hide or they take as a protection, and they can make like a kind of tricks. And people, they call them a magician. But he's a mushawad, he's an illusionist or someone who's charlatan, you know, seeking money or doing like tricks. But he's not a magician. But because he's being called magician, some of the scholars, they said that this person, he need to be like, you know, because one of the depends of actually on the action of certain magician, when it, the action is really action of kufr, of rejection, of mafsada, of a mischief that leads to disbelief. Those, waliyadu billah, their sanction is death. So if anyone charlatan or illusionist or someone who's, you know, doing tricks, you call a magician, therefore you want to exist, you know, to implement the hukum of death penalty on them, this is a fawda, this is a mission. That's what he's saying here. Why? Because the fact that he's being called a magician without studying or going depth to see what the ill thing that he's doing to be qualified or to be, you know, deserve this high level of law that being legislated for such category. But he's saying here, قَالَ وَقَدْ أَخْطَأَ وَلَقَدْ أَخْطَأَ مِنْ هُنَا بَعْضُ الْفُقَهَاءِ أَخْطَاءً كَثِيرًا. مثل إفتاء بعضهم, like the إفتاء, the fatwa, or some of them, بِقَتْلِ الْمُشَعْوِذِ, to kill the مُشَعْوِذ. Why? Because they call him magician, سَحَر. مُغْمِذِينَ أَعْيُنِهُمْ أَوْ مُغْمِذِينَ أَعْيُنَهُمْ عَنْ تَحْقِيقِ مَعْنَى السِّحْرِ الَّذِي نَاطَ الشَّارِعُ بِهِ حُكْمَ الْقَتْلِ. Without neglecting the aspect of, you know, related to the magic which led to the law of the Sharia and the punishment in the Sharia related to this category, particular category of magician. Because not everyone called magician you want to punish him or to become kafir. Those magicians is really people who are like enemy to the society. People who really, you know, have that level of disbelief. But if you study their action, they are really evil action. Really evil action. Nothing have to do with some tricks. So if someone will jump to the judgment and to the law without studying or without investigating on the action, and then to see if this action that this person is doing is really at the level of that type of magic who need or to be punished, you know, according to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَالَ فَمِنْ حَقِّ الْفَقِيهِ إِذَا تَكَلَّمَ عَلَى السِّحْرِ أَوْ سُئِلَ عَنْ أَنْ يُبَيِّنَ أَوْ يَسْتَبِينَ صِفَتَهُ وَحَقِيقَتَهُ. So it is from the requirement of the jurist when he's been talked about such a thing, he need to ask the question and to know why this such action, you know, its punishment is such a thing. وَأَلَّا يُفْتِي بِمُجَرَّ ذِكْرَ السَّحْرِ. And he doesn't have the right to give the fatwa by just mentioning the name. فَيَقُولُ يُقْتَلُ السَّاحُ وَلَا تُقْبَلُ تَوْبَتُ. And he say the sahab need to be executed and his repentance could not be accepted, and this is one of the big measures here to be done. For someone to make a fatwa with no knowledge, and here the no knowledge like that he need to investigate, and he knows what is related to the sihr as a major sin who deserve the punishment that you mentioned. So that's what he given some of the other thing that he mentioned from the example. قال ولما كذلك لما ظهرت الحبوب اليمنية الحبوب اليمنية الحبوب اليمنية are the seeds, Yemeni seeds. This Yemeni seeds is the coffee that we have today. Some of the scholars in the beginning of the 10th century Hijri, they had the fatwa that these hubub are haram. Why? Because the name of this seed is named qahwa. Qahwa. Al-qahwa in the Arabic language is the intoxicant. وهو اسم الخمر في اللغة العربية. قهوة اسم الخمر في اللغة العربية. قهوة is the name of wine in the Arabic language. So they said these seeds are haram. But the name of قهوة has been, taken from a different language. It happened to be like close to قهوة. So coffee, كفة they call it. In the language, so when you translate it or you make it, in the Arabic language, there's qahwa. So when people they say qahwa, this color they say qahwa when they look. Qahwa means intoxicant, means wine, so this is haram. So, are you looking for the pages?
Yes, someone says
the chapter is in the page 171. And the example that I'm given in the thing. He said something that I don't. Those in the third paragraph, the paragraph before the last one in page 172. Equally, the occurrence was the fatwa issued by some juristic scholars prohibiting the consumption of the Yemeni beans known as coffee when it was discovered at the beginning of the 10th century because of its name, qahwa, which means wine in Arabic. Although qahwa, when applied to the beans, was actually corruption of the non-Arabic French word café. Therefore, jurists have always sought to distinguish the attributes taken into account by the lawgiver, Sharia, from those that are merely associated with them, that have nothing to do with the purpose of the Sharia. So this is the end of page 172. Okay. Now, ولذلك فإن الأسماء الشرعية إنما تعتبر باعتبار مطابقتها للمعاني الملحوظة شرعا في مسمياتها عند وضع المصطلحات الشرعية. Now the Sharia name and around it is the law is made. It need to be taken or understood according to its attributes, to its reason. فإذا تغير المسمى لم يكن لوجود الاسم اعتبار. The khamr is haram. Why? Because it's intoxicant. If you change the name of the khamr to another name, like they call it today, name it. They call it spiritual drink. Then you call spiritual drink becomes halal. So the changing of the name doesn't have any atibar. Why? Because the content is the same. And vice versa. If the content, you change it and you still call it wine, that content is not haram. Why? Because it doesn't have the aspect that made it haram, which is the reason why the wine is became haram, because it's intoxicating. وَقَدْ أَنذَرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. This is the last paragraph in this. وَقَدْ أَنذَرَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنذَارًا بِإِنْكَارِ أناس من أمته يشربون الخمر يسمونها بغير اسمها. He warned the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم already. He said there will come people from my ummah. They will make the wine halal by naming different names. Likewise, that just the alteration of name has no effect in legalizing what is forbidden. So too, it has no effect in terms of prohibiting what is lawful. فكما كان تغيير الاسم غير مؤثر في تحريم الحرام كذلك لا يكون مؤثرا في تحريم الحلال. So if you change the name, it will not help someone to legalize what is haram. And the same thing, you cannot make the halal haram by giving it a haram name. وبعبارة أشمل لا تكون التسمية مناط الحكم. المناط is what you know make the law, or what you know establish and construct the law. The name nothing have to do with the construction of the law. In the reason is the illa. In the spirit is the intent. In the effect. That's what made the law, not the name. And all of this need to be taken in consideration when someone is implementing or trying to extract new laws from the source of the Sharia. قال وتلك الأوصاف هي مناط الحكم. Those attributes, that's what made the law. The attributes made the law. Because the maslaha, remember, all the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being legislated for a maslaha, for a benefit. For, قَالَ جَلْبُ مَصْلَحَ أَوْ دَفْعُ مَفْسَدَ. جَلْبُ مَصْلَحَ أَوْ دَفْعُ مَفْسَدَ is to acquire a benefit, an advantage, or to remove or start a mission or anything. So these are the manatul hukm. These are the heart and the core of the law. ومن هذا القبيل النهي عن الانتباه في الحنتم والجر والمزفت المقصود أنها يسرع إليها الاختمار. In some hadith, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he wrote to a town or to community, tell them, it is forbidden to store your, you know, what they have as food, kind of dates at the time, or like the juice of the day, or things at type of foods, to store them or to eat them in this type of pots, utensil. Some of them they call it al-hantamu wal-jabu wal-muzaffat. So this is type of pots. Now, if someone will have this type of pot to say, you cannot tell this haram to eat in. Say why? Because the Prophet ﷺ said so. I said you have to understand and to investigate why the Prophet ﷺ said haram. Because in this type of utensil and this type of pots, in that type of climate, the storage of the certain food in it make it, subhanAllah, to get fermented very fast, so they become intoxicant. If you put in it, for example, the what they extract from the dates, the dates turn into intoxicant, so it becomes like alcohol. So using this type of pots, in that type of environment and climate and store into food is going to turn to be intoxicant. So to prevent such thing, the Prophet said to that specific community, said, do not use this one. Because of a reason. So you cannot say all this part called Al-Hantam, you cannot use it. Say, no, you can't use it as long as storing the food in it will may not, you know, turn it into intoxicant. Any question?
You said, is there any rulings when we name a name that's associated with something that's bad for something that's good? So for example, let's just take the wine example. You know, wine is haram. But you use wine for something that's good. And what the Sharia think about it? I mean, what's the consequence maybe for generations down the road if you start refusing which is a good wine, which is a bad wine? So naming those names could actually bring problems down the road if you use a bad name for a good thing.
The initiative is not from the Muslim to name a lawful thing with a bad name. But you're living in a society where they do such a thing. And when we offer something, so you say, someone says, do not drink it, it's haram. So that's where we need to be specific and careful. Do not make everything around us haram. Because, for example, say, oh, this is nice to drink, it's actually spiritual. Say, no, this is haram because look how many alcohol it has. Wow, 40%, it's haram. So he gave him the proof that it's haram, not from the name, from the content. So if they call it, so it's not the initiative. Is not, from the behavior of the conduct of the moral of the Muslim, is something lawful to give it a name that is lawful and that is good. But it's not the initiative of the Muslim to do such a thing. But if it's done, we cannot make it haram. A certain tradition, for example, they might call it something that it looks as haram, but when you look at the content, or you study it, you say, yes, well, this is not haram. Why you make it haram? And it happened, many people, they have, many things in their mind that is haram. And they said, no, it's not haram, said, we didn't know that. But everybody, we grow up, people, they say it's haram. There's a lot of things. I'll give you an example. Seeing people, for example, stretching their legs towards the tummy. In some society, that is not accepted, it's haram. They do say it's haram. What started with a good etiquette turned to be a sin. What started to be good etiquette turned to be a sin. So when someone is saying, for example, reprimanding and almost like insulting someone because you saw him like setting his legs in the public. That person, for example, might be, he doesn't know that. Or living in society, he never heard about that. So not only insulting him, hurting his feeling, and they causing like enmity and like, you know, dispute and maybe fight because of something that doesn't exist in this. Or someone, for example, there's this, everyone who wants to drink, he has to sit down. Example. What starts as etiquette, it becomes like an obligation. When it becomes an obligation, people, they see it like anyone who doesn't do it, it becomes like habit. Action, for example, there's difference of opinion between the scholars. If you take one of these opinion and you make it to be the law of Islam, and then you use it to reprimand everyone else and to make everyone else sinner because of that opinion. So many people, they... So these, I mean, we live a lot of these circumstances or a lot of this condition, if you can say, in our communities, in societies. Well, it's not haram. So sometimes, in many examples, sometimes you say to someone, that this is not haram. Say, why did you know? Alhamdulillah, say, yeah, now you know. And there's many people, they do things that are haram and they believe that it's halal. Say, Akhi, this is wrong what you do. This is haram. Say, I didn't know. Now you know. Now you know. So why is everything comes back to the content, to the essence, to the attributes. When something, for example, etiquette, like we mentioned, the stretching of the legs toward the qibla. Say, what is the dalil? There's no dalil. So you cannot make something haram without justifying in the Book of Allah or the Sunnah of the Prophet. Any other question? The next chapter is أحكام الشريعة قابلة للقياس. This is one of the one of very important and crucial aspects in the legislation, the Islamic jurisprudence. Analogical reasoning based on effective causes and medium and high Sharia objectives. The analogy in the Sharia, which will help me to deduct other laws, because the text is limited. I mean, limited in size and limited in issues that we treated. But the issue that being confronted by everyone in all this time and society is almost infinite. So, how can, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Quran was revealed, they have very limited issues? And other Prophet ﷺ, or actually Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, said, يَحْدُثُ فِي النَّاسِ مِنْ قَضَايَا أَوْ نَوَازِلْ. It happened to people from issues and troubles and problems, you know, the more they themselves they do problem and they go through. To find the laws for these new issues, this is the mechanism of ijtihad. The mechanism of ijtihad is only possible if the law itself revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had that ability to serve as analogy, to serve as example. So if we say there is no analogy, or we cannot make an analogical deduction from all the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore we say the mechanism of ijtihad is not possible. That's why when we, the Zahiri school, they say the qiyas is not existing or the qiyas is not allowed in the Sharia, is like we say to the Zahiri school, you are putting a handicap, restricting the whole Sharia from really progressing and be a solution for the generation to come. So in this chapter, the author, he's shown us, the objective of the chapter, to show us that the qiyas is something very obvious and natural into the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't need to make, you know, justification or validation or show, you know, by evidence that the law of Allah can be subject to qiyas. No, they are naturally in the way of the qiyas. Why? Because of the shatr we have already have studied. It's not about the names. It's about the essence. It's about the attributes. That's why he said based on effective causes and medium. So in the Arabic here, that's why I refer always to the Arabic, which is the original text. قَالَ قَابِلَ الْقِيَاسِ عَلَيْهَا بِاعْتِبَارِ الْعِلَلْ وَالْمَقَاصِدِ الْقَلِيلَ وَالْعَالِيَ. So we have three levels. الْعِلَّةُ المقصد القريب والمقصد العالي. العلة is the reason for which the law was established. The reason for which the law was established. For example, we're talking about the wine. Because of the intoxication that the wine, the conception of the wine caused, they become haram. The wine turned into vinegar, it becomes halal. Why? Because it doesn't have that ability of intoxicating. One. So this is the ilm. Maqasid qalila, an intent, the law is constructed. Also, it has in it some intent that is like we say qariba, close intent, which is close intent has like in a specific category, which is talking about them here. Qala maqasid qariba مثل حفظ العقل, حفظ العقل, to protect the intellect. The intoxicant is haram because of intoxication. When you go higher, what is the intent behind that? Is to protect the brain, is to protect the intellect. Because people, if they consume intoxicant, then they will not have right reasoning. That they're going to be spreading mission, they're going to not be planning. They're not going to be decision, they're going to be like chaos. So to protect the intellect, to protect the brain, that's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who helped me to project, to plan, to do good. To protect it, Allah made the intoxicant to be haram. Allah made the drugs to be haram. So this is another higher intent. You see, the first one we said, if you take the khamr, the inter khamr, the wine. The first illah is intoxicant. The higher intent than the illah is to protect the brain, to protect the intellect. Now, the highest one is to stop emission. So you see, in every hukum, you find these three layers of intent from the direct effect of the hukum to the close intent, like the saving and protecting the brain, to the highest one, which is to remove and stop any mission. وَإِنْ كَانَتْ كُلِّيَاتٌ عَالِيَةٌ سَمَّيْنَاهَا مَقَاصِدْ عَالِيَةٌ. So we call it high objective. It's like to stop a mission.
Azan is already called in the program.
Should we start here? You want to come back? Okay, this is the first class after the long break, so start up. I meet you next week, inshallah. Any question before we... Can you please study the chapter? I'll give you one more. Study the chapter, inshallah. And I'll ask you a question. And try to read the next chapter, chapter 22, page 177. Just to read it, inshallah. Because is talking about التحيل or الهيلة, manipulation and tricks in Sharia, which is a very good subject. التحيل is wrong. But it can be used in a way that you have to accept it because what is being done is Sharia, is lawful, is legalized, is validated. But to enter here into this, our subject and our topic, to see how it can be like its relation with the ijtihad and how the scholar need to be you know, aware from such actions. طيب جزاكم الله خيرا وبارك الله.